Hi, this is COMP1010 at the University of Manitoba. I'm Dr. Celine LaTulip, and today I'm going to be talking about analyzing efficiency. So we earlier looked at a play cards program, a program that used an array of integers to store 52 cards, and we were shuffling the cards and displaying them. And so one of the things that we want to often do in software development is test our programs. So we might want to write a test to see if the shuffle is working. Is every card that's in the deck still there after shuffling? Always? Do we know this for sure? When we ran the program, it sort of looked okay. And we can actually physically, visually count as a user, but that's not a very efficient way of testing. Let's rerun the play cards program just to refresh what it looks like. So here's our play cards program. It displays all 52 cards, and when we click, it shuffles, and we see the cards are all over the place. So we could look at this visually and inspect and make sure all the cards are there, but that's not very good. We want to test to make sure that it always runs well, and we want to do this programmatically. So we can actually write a function that will do this kind of test just to make sure that there isn't some subtle bug that's happening every once in a while. So we want to write a couple of functions, and one of them would be validate deck. And with this function, we're going to pass in the deck, which is the array of integers, and we're going to check and make sure that all the cards are in there from 0 to 51. And it's going to return a Boolean, either true or false, if it finds them or not, all of them or not. And then we'll write another function that actually calls validate deck. We'll call this the shuffler test, and we'll pass in an int, which is the number of tests we want to run. So maybe we want to run 10 tests or 1,000 tests and have it call validate deck that many times and just keep on testing to make sure that there isn't some subtle bug that we're missing. And shuffler test will also return a Boolean. If all of the tests pass, it'll return true. And if any of the tests fail, then it will return false. So let's take a look at what these functions look like. And this is code that's in shuffletest.pde. Now the code I'm going to show you uses a bigger deck, and it doesn't display the cards because with a bigger deck, it's hard to display that many cards. So here's our validate deck function. Remember, this we're passing in the deck, and we're going to go through and check to make sure that every number card from 0 up to deck size is in the deck, and will return true if it is and false otherwise. So this is the code that does that. So first we create a Boolean variable that is called deck valid, and we're going to start by assuming it's true. And again, this structure of function allows us to have just one return call at the end of the function. Then we're going to have a for loop that goes through the deck from 0 up to the deck size, and as long as deck valid is true. And so we've already just set that to true, so we're going to definitely get into this loop. But at some point, if we find that a card is missing, then we'll set deck valid to false and we won't keep on looping. So then we have to do another for loop. So in this outer for loop, we're counting through the numbers that we know are in our deck from 0 up to deck size. So we start with number 0, and now we're going to loop through the actual deck that was passed in and see if we can find 0. And we have to do this because after shuffling, we don't know where card 0 will be. So we're going to go through the deck from 0 up to deck size, and we're going to look and see if we can find the card we're looking for. The first time it'll be 0, the next time it'll be 1, etc. If we find it, then we say true, and we stop this inner loop. And then we go back out to the outer loop, and we look at the next card. So then we look at card 1, etc. So if we ever get through the whole deck and we haven't found a card number that we're looking for, then card found down here is going to be, so we started it off as false, and it's going to still be false. And so if not false, which is true, then our whole deck is false and we haven't got a good shuffle. We were missing a card after the shuffle. And then we're going to return deck valid. And so if we didn't find a card, deck valid will be false, we return false. If we get through this entire outer for loop, we've searched for every card, we've found every card, then deck valid stays true and we return true. So that's one algorithm to test. And then the other function, which is shuffler test, is pretty simple. We're just going to call this number of test times. So we're going to loop number of test times, we're going to shuffle the deck, and then we're going to call validate deck. And if it returns false, then our pass value is going to be set to false, and we're going to return false. So we won't pass the test. We call this from our setup function. So we do if shuffler test and we pass in some numbers. And if we do pass, then we say pass. If we don't pass, then we say test failed, shuffler is bad. So let's run this and have a look at what this looks like. So this is not the play cards function. We're going to go to shuffle test. So again, here's our code. We have the setup. We're calling shuffler test, and shuffler test down here is going to call validate deck some number of times. And here's our validate deck function, which is what I just showed you. And let's have a look here at what our numbers are. So in this version, we're using a deck size of 5,200. So that's a lot bigger than a 52 card deck. This is 5,200 cards. And we're gonna run 10,000 tests. So we're gonna test this really thoroughly. If it doesn't fail after running it 10,000 times, then we've probably got a pretty good algorithm in our shuffle. So let's not run this right now, because what I want to do is run it when we have a comparison. But I wanted to show you what this code looks like. Okay, so there is a smarter way to do this. So the function that we just showed you, the validate deck function, has these nested for loops. So for each number from zero up to deck size, we're going to search through the entire deck from the first card in the deck to the end of the deck to see if it's the number we're looking for. So that's really inefficient. It's very slow, it's pretty bad. Here's a different way that we could do this. So what we could do is we could create an array of Booleans. And for each card in the deck, so we just go through the deck that we have that we're passed in, we look at the card and we use that number as an index into our array of Booleans, and we say, ah, this one's true, we found this card. So we do that for every card in our deck, and then we loop through the array of Booleans and make sure that they're all true, see if every card has been found. So this is sort of a faster way. And we'll take a look at what that looks like now. So this one is in shuffle-test-fast.pde. So here's that algorithm. So here we go, validate deck. Again, we're passing in a deck. We create an array of Boolean variables. We're gonna call that array found, and we make that array deck size. So you have to remember here that when you create an array of Boolean variables, the default value of a Boolean is false. So this is going to be an array of deck size falses. Okay. And then we're going to loop through our deck from zero to deck size. And this line of code here is a little bit tricky. What we're doing is we're getting the value out of deck. We're using that integer as an index into our found, our array of Booleans, and we're setting that to true. And I'll break this down for you just so that you get it in a second. And then once we've done that, we loop through from zero up to deck size. And all we're doing is looking at our array of Booleans and seeing if we find a false. So if a variable here is, if we say not of that variable, that Boolean, then if it's false, not false is going to be true. And that means that we didn't find that card. So I'm going to break down this line of code right here for you, because it might be a little confusing when you've just learned arrays. So this loop could be rewritten this way. So we go from zero up to deck size, and we're looking at the deck of cards that we have. So we're going to store a temporary int, which is what number of card is at this point in the deck. So deck of I, when I is zero, we're going to get whatever number that card is. We're going to store it in card. And then we're going to use that number as an index into our array of Booleans. So found of card gets set to true. And we come back up. We go to the next card in our deck. We figure out what the number of that card is. We use that as an index into our array of Booleans again and set that slot in the array of Booleans to true. So these two lines of code are equivalent to this one line of code. This is written in a more compact way. They are identical in terms of what they do. This one may be a little easier to understand when you're first getting used to arrays. So the point here, though, is that we still have two for loops, but these two for loops are not nested. Okay. They both loop from zero to deck size. So, but this one is a lot better. So why is this one better and how much better is it? So let's actually go and run these two algorithms. So here's shuffle test, which is the first one. And here's shuffle test fast, which is the second one. So I'm going to expand both of these. And we want to note that in both cases, we are using a deck size of 5,200 and we are going to run 10,000 tests. Okay. So I am going to bring up a Google stopwatch over here and we're going to run these two. So let's do the shuffle test first. So this is the one that has the nested for loops. So for each card number, we're looking through the deck to see if we can find it. So we're looking through the whole deck. And so we're going to run this and then I'm going to go over and press start on the stopwatch. So click and come over here and click. All right. So we're waiting for a result down here to say run test shuffle is valid or whatever the output is. So we're at 10 seconds now, 12 seconds. This is taking a little while. 15 seconds, 20 seconds, still waiting to see what's happening, 25 seconds, it's running 10,000 tests with a deck of 5,200 cards. Not sure how long this is going to take, hopefully not too much longer. And we're waiting, and we're waiting. Still going, we're at 42 seconds. So this is pretty slow. So 10,000 tests with a deck of 5,200 cards. Oh, and it passed. And that was, I don't know, it looked like it was about 53 seconds. Okay, so that's a pretty slow algorithm because 5,200 data elements, 5,200 cards is not very many data elements. And to run 10,000 tests, that took a long time. So here's our shuffle test fast. And this is the one that has two for loops, but they're not nested loops. First, we're setting the array of Booleans all to false. Then we're going through and we're looking at the deck and we're changing things in that Boolean array. And then we're checking that Boolean array, just going through it to see if all of the items, all of the slots are now set to true. So we are going to reset our stopwatch and we're going to run this shuffle test fast. And again, same number, 5,200 cards, 10,000 tests. So let's run that. So it's running and let's come over here and start. Oh, look at that. I didn't even get to press the start button before this test passed. So this is much, much faster. So let's talk about this. Why is that faster? The first algorithm is doing an outer loop n times, however many cards are in your deck. And again, this is that code. For each one of those cards, we're then doing an inner loop. And that inner loop could go, it's probably not going to go n times. We're going to stop whenever we find the card if we're looking for it. And on average, we're going to get about halfway through the deck before we found a card and we bail out. So the inner loop is going to probably go about n over 2 times, with n being the size of our deck. So it's going n times for the outer loop, and for each of those n times, it's going n over 2 times. So that's n times n over 2. And so that's n squared over 2 operations. And this is what, in computer science, we call order n squared. So this notation here becomes important later on. You don't need to know it right now, but we'd like to just sort of make you aware of it. So this is a classification of algorithm, and n squared algorithms are not great. So let's look at the second algorithm. The second algorithm does the first loop n times. This is where we go through the deck and we mark things in the Boolean array. And that takes n times, however big the deck is. And then it separately does the second loop. And the second loop also goes from 0 up to the deck size. So it also runs n times. So this second algorithm runs n plus n times, or 2n operations. And so for this one, we say this is order of n, or what we would call linear. So let's look at some numbers. N squared over 2 is way, way bigger than 2 times n. How bigger? Well, if we had a deck that was 5,200 cards, which is what we just showed, and again, that's not a lot of data for a modern program, n squared over 2 when n is 5200 is 13,520,000. So that's how many operations the slow shuffle test had to do. 2 times n when n is 5200 is 10,400. So that's far, far fewer operations. And so this second algorithm is actually 1,300 times faster than the first algorithm. So these different rates, these different classifications of functions, are what you'll study as you go on in computer science. And we often represent these as these sort of growth rates of functions. And so this green line here shows a linear function, which is what our fast shuffle test does. It's linear, it's order n right here. And as the data size gets bigger, it doesn't get that much slower. This is the number of operations on the y-axis. But our slow shuffle was order n squared, which is this blue line here. And you can see that as the data gets big, really quickly, it gets really slow. It takes a lot more operations to do anything. So when you get to COMP 2080, you'll be able to really dive into this stuff, studying the efficiency of algorithms. All right, that's it. Thanks for watching.